Good morning. Welcome to another week, and thank you for the great day yesterday. I sure love church. I remember the first, after I got saved, I remember the first time going into a Baptist church. I left for college, saved on a Wednesday, left for college on Saturday, and shortly, I can't remember exactly when, but it wasn't long, the coach of the basketball team there was a member of the Baptist church, and he invited me to go. And I remember sitting there and hearing the message, hearing a solo, a lovely lady singing a solo. And that church, that was the beginning of my Christian life. My Bible reading started that Saturday, saved on Wednesday. Saturday in a motel, began reading the Bible. And that was the beginning of my closeness to the Lord. But oh, church is such a precious place. The fellowship of the believers, hearing each other sing, learning to harmonize with one another, hearing the preaching, having our heads bowed together in prayer, having an invitation where people would walk an aisle, seeing people get baptized who trusted Christ. There's nothing quite like the Christian life and nothing like the church that Christ purchased with his own blood. I wanted to read you a quick story today. This is my book on hymns and the story behind the hymns. The hymn, He Leadeth Me. He leadeth me, O blessed thought, O words with heavenly comfort fraught. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. Sometimes mid scenes of deepest gloom, sometimes where Eden's bowers bloom, by waters still or troubled sea, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. When my task on earth is done, when by thy grace the victory's won, in death's cold wave I will not flee, since God through Jordan leadeth me. And just the simple truth, he leads me. It's a personal thing. He leads me. God is going to lead me. He's going to direct me. He's going to protect me. He's going to guide me. I'm going to make it through this Christian life, through the battles. Interesting story about Joseph Gilmore, the author of this book. He wrote it in March of 1862, and he wrote, these are his words of when he wrote the book. I'd been speaking at the Wednesday evening service for the First Baptist Church in Philadelphia, the corner of Broad and Arch Streets. I've been speaking on the 23rd Psalm and had been especially impressed with the blessedness of being led by God. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He leadeth me beside still waters. At the close of the service, we adjourned to Deacon Watson's pleasant home where we were being entertained. During our conversation, the blessedness of God's leading so grew upon me that I took out my pencil and wrote the hymn just as it stands today. Handed it to my wife and thought no more of it. So they're sitting there eating, drinking, fellowshipping, and he's scribbling these words. Hands it to his wife and forgets about it. She sent it, without my knowledge, to the Watchman and Reflector magazine. And there it first appeared in print. 3 years later, I went to Rochester, New York, to preach as a candidate for the Second Baptist Church. Upon entering the chapel, I took up a hymn book thinking, I wonder what they sing. The book opened to the song, He Leadeth Me. And that was the first time I knew that my hymn had found a place among the songs of the church. And he wrote other hymns and had a great testimony, great ministry, pastored several Baptist churches. But just the thought of God's word and the idea that God's hand leads us. And the principle here to me is scripture ought to be a part of us. We ought to think on it and meditate on it. And how precious those words have been. That song's been translated to languages all over the world. He leadeth me, O blessed thought. And could I tell you, whatever it is that you're facing, what our nation is facing, whatever difficulties the world throws at us. This world's not our home. We're at war. We're soldiers. We're strangers and pilgrims, Peter called us. And we're just here for a little while. We're just passing through. And whatever battle's thrown our way, God's going to lead us. And he's faithful. We're not trusting in our abilities. We're trusting in God's faithfulness. I wanted to take a moment and just reflect on a couple of thoughts. In John chapter 7, if you want to turn there, it's an interesting little statement. Now, you know who Nicodemus is. John chapter 3, Nicodemus is a ruler of the Jews. He comes to Jesus by night, says, "We know thou art a teacher, come from God. No man can do the things you do except God be with him," and on and on. Jesus turns to Nicodemus and says, "You must be born again." The discussion goes on between the religious leader and the Savior. And Nicodemus leaves. Later, on a couple of occasions, Nicodemus finds himself in this crowd of religious leaders who did not have faith in Christ. And at some point, we don't know where, at some point Nicodemus made his decision that he believed Jesus was who he said he was. Well, in John chapter 7, they're busy slandering Jesus. They were on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, just slamming Jesus. And the officers they'd sent to arrest Jesus, they came back without him, and they said, "Never a man spake like this man speaketh." And they said, "Are ye also deceived? Have any of the rulers or the Pharisees believed on him? But this people," I'm in verse 49, "this people who know not the Lord are cursed." These are judgmental, critical know-it-alls. Verse 50, "Nicodemus saith unto them," he that came to Jesus by night, being one of them, "Doth our law judge any man before it hear him, and know what he doeth? And they answered and said to him, Art thou also of Galilee? Search and look, for out of Galilee ariseth no prophet." And every man went to his own house. Now, they were saying he couldn't be any prophetic man. He couldn't be any prophet foretold in the Old Testament because no prophet came from Galilee. Well, first of all, that's wrong. If I'm not mistaken, it was Jonah who came from that region. But regardless of that, if they would have done their homework, they'd have found Jesus was born in Bethlehem. And they would have known Micah 5:2, Bethlehem, Ephrathah, out of these shall he come forth, who shall be ruler, and on and on. But they didn't do their homework. They just were busy slandering. And that's the point today, as we talk about this thing of judging and slandering and criticizing. In a little statement in verse 51, Nicodemus said, "Doth our law judge any man before it hear him and know what he doeth?" You know, in America, if you want to look over to Deuteronomy 19, in America, it's an interesting idea that a man is innocent until he's proven guilty. A man is innocent until he's proven guilty. That's a Bible principle, but it's an American principle. The idea that when I go into a courtroom, I'm innocent. And I'm standing before probably an unsaved judge, an unsaved jury, probably the most evil prosecutors and defend. Somebody said if all the attorneys in the world were laid head to foot around the equator, it'd be a good thing. And just leave them there. But I would be in an environment that would be not godly, not like church. And yet, if people understand our law, when I walk into that room, I'm innocent. And I have to be proven beyond a shadow of a doubt to be guilty. And one of our ladies, I mentioned this before, but one of our ladies was on jury duty. And as they were doing jury selection, the defendant's attorney was interviewing potential jurors, and he said to one of our ladies from our church, he said, "If you're in this room here, and this person's going to try and prove my client guilty, and I'm going to try and prove them innocent. So in the spectrum from guilty to innocent, where would you place yourself?" And she, in a very noble, Christian fashion, said, "Well, I think right in the middle. Neither guilty nor innocent, just in the middle." And he said, "That's nice, ma'am, except in America, you start out innocent." And that made such an impact on her. I've heard her tell that story a couple of times, and her husband's told it a couple of times. And it was the eye-opener, and I think that attorney did a great job, because you're not equally guilty and innocent. You are innocent. See, when our founders came to America, there was so much prejudice to prejudge. And you came into a courtroom, and from your hometown, from your career, from your background, they already had a decision. You were standing before a Catholic or a Protestant leader, and maybe a law enforcement or military judge, perhaps a sovereign, like a king, only on a smaller scale. And you walked into that room, you knew you were probably guilty, unless you could somehow prove your own innocence. And a lot of innocent people died, a lot of innocent people in prison. And so when our founders came to America, and then when the framers began putting together our Constitution, our Bill of Rights, and the laws that upon our lands, upon which our land is built, those people put in the idea that in our judicial system, you're innocent. You come into the courtroom assumed innocence. And you know, it's a wonderful thing. The problem is, it's not that way among the common citizens. Somebody in the news says, this cop shot this guy. And a huge segment of our population will say the cop is guilty. They've not heard it, seen it. They've not interviewed. They've not talked to anybody. They just passed judgment. They heard one side and only part of one side, and they already passed judgment. One person that you know or I know says something on social media, and because we know them, why would they lie? I can't even imagine what would motivate them to lie. So they must be telling the truth. Therefore, I believe what they say, and this person is guilty. And we become judge, jury, and executioner. And yet, I think we'd all be willing to admit that the Bible says that God be true and every man a liar. People lie. People are mistaken. I mean, they get the wrong story. And sometimes people are hurt and they tell the wrong story. And sometimes people are just bad and they just flat out lie. And all those things come into play. And so I'm not going to, somebody tells me something, I'm not going to say liar, liar, but I'm not going to believe it and accept it as true. I just can't. Look with me there at Deuteronomy chapter 19. Now, most of the laws in America are founded on the Ten Commandments, and then many of the laws are founded on the principles taken off the Ten Commandments throughout the book of Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. But if you look at Deuteronomy chapter 19, verse 1, look at this. One witness shall not rise up against a man for any iniquity, for any sin, in any sin that he sinneth. One witness can't even, they are not even supposed to accuse. We're not saying that we're going to judge the guy as guilty. He says one witness shall not rise up. If I'm the only one to testify against you, then I have no business testifying. I am not to rise up in testimony against you. It's wrong. It's unscriptural. It's wrong. It's wrong to even bring up the idea. That's how wrong. That's how much God believes in justice. Let's read on. At the mouth of two witnesses, or at the mouth of three witnesses, shall the matter be established. If you have at least two or three witnesses, verse 16, if a false witness rise up against any man to testify against him that which is wrong, like Supreme Court justices face, like our president has faced, if a false witness rises up, so this person comes up and says and gives false testimony against that person, verse 17, then both men before whom the controversy is shall stand before the Lord, and before the priests and the judges. So there's God, the priests, and the judges, which shall be in those days. So there's appointed people to do this job. There's judges, that's their job. They're appointed. There are religious leaders, that's their job. And of course, God, he's got his job. Verse 18, and the judges shall make diligent inquisition, and behold, if the witness be a false witness, and have testified falsely against his brother, then shall ye do to him as he had thought to have done to his brother, so shalt thou put the evil away from among you. And he goes on to say, and everybody's going to hear and be afraid. So I rise up and say by myself, or a couple of us, by myself, it's not even legal for me to accuse by myself. So two or three of us come as witnesses. We then can accuse, but we can only accuse to the appointed judges and rulers. We can't just go to social media and slander and ridicule. That is unscriptural behavior. That is sinful, and it's wrong. But if I were to take my story and two or three others of us, and we were to go to the judge and present our case before the judge, then the judge makes diligent inquisition. He looks and asks and interviews and talks to people, and then he passes judgment on whether whatever's to be done. And my job is done. Once I have brought my story to the proper judge or authority, I am to shut up, because I am not the investigator. I'm not the judge. I'm not the priest. I'm not the one who decides whether this person's name and reputation is destroyed. That's not my job according to the law. And so the judge makes the decision, and I'm out of it. Now, if the judge makes diligent inquisition and finds out that I was lying, that I brought a false report against this person, then whatever would have happened to that person had I prevailed, that same punishment will be meted out to me as a deceitful witness. And the goal there in the next verse, verse 19 and 20, then that all people might hear and be afraid. We ought to be afraid of passing judgment on people. We ought to be fearful of spreading false information. We ought to be very concerned that we would pass along information that's not accurate, because God says he'll hold every word accountable. We're going to be accountable for every idle word. And God is the judge. And I love that little statement. Abraham said to God, shall not the judge of all the earth do right? And the answer is rhetorical. A rhetorical question, of course, God will do right. And yet, in our culture, one newspaper report, one radio or TV news reporter makes one statement, and this person passes it along, and that person passes it along, and suddenly we're crucifying people's past, present, and future. We're destroying their marriage, their children, their reputation. We're destroying who they are, who they were, and who they might one day become, all on the basis of information which we have not documented. We have not, over there where we started out in the Gospel of John, that simple statement of Nicodemus in John 7:51, doth our law judge any man before it hear him and know what he doeth? I hear something about you on social media, and I hit the like button or the share button, and suddenly that thing goes along. And if I have not talked to you, if I've not gotten the story straight, if I've not gotten both sides of the story, I am a criminal. Not only that, if the person bringing the accusation brings it alone, they are the criminal. But not only that, if they bring it to me, and I'm not a judge, I'm not the judge, jury, executioner, they bring that information just to random people, they're even more so, they're doubly a criminal. Because that's what we used to call gossip and slander. That's what we used to call defamation of character. Because it's not this person's job as an individual to make themselves investigator and judge and prosecutor, that then they take my name or your name and demolish that name. And these poor Supreme Court justices, there are people need to go to jail. There are people in the attacks on our president, the very idea. Let me give you a quick statistic. The the people who have said of our president and of other conservatives that they're racist, I challenge you, and you should challenge others. I won't tell you the statistics. Go back at the last four or five presidents. Just pick your number of presidents. Go back and pick two, three, four, five presidents. Pick Democrats and Republicans and see who had the most minorities working for them. Just see who had the most minorities in their cabinet, in their advisors, in their executive offices surrounding them. See. And when someone says of a conservative they're racist, I would happily say, would you go look at every liberal president, every conservative president, and bring me back the numbers of minorities that they had close to them? Then you hear statements about conservatives, especially our current president, that he's anti-woman. Well, all right, let's just go back and let's find out from the past three or four presidents, which presidents had the most women in high positions of leadership. Go ahead and do the homework. We've got the internet. It's simple to get these facts. And the thing that's most amazing is just like Ruth Ginsburg, the recently deceased Supreme Court justice, the defender of liberty, the one who stood for the minority and the oppressed, look at her court clerks. Look at the people she surrounded her with. Look at the people she hired. And they were, I saw the picture, and I don't know everybody because she had several hundred clerks over the years, but everybody I saw was a young white male. A young white male. Where's the racist slander toward her? Where's the gender slander toward her? And to me, I think she's free. Hire who you want. I really am a strong American. I believe go do what you want. But if somebody wants to attack someone and say they are racist, then there better be some facts behind it. And you got still, I have no right to slander you to the general public. That is not scriptural. It is so wrong. But we read there in John, doth our law judge any man before it? Here, you ought to at least ask. You ought to at least go eyeball to eyeball. And I challenge you to start shutting down social media that's gossip and slander. I mean, delete them, defriend them, bar them, whatever you do. I have no social media. I don't understand how it, and I know it all evolves and all that. But I challenge you, when somebody is passing along information that is none of their business, we used to call them busybodies. And nobody, he said over in Peter, he said, I think it's Peter, he said, let none of you be accused of a murderer, as a thief, or as a busybody in other men's matters. Now, if it's the judge's job to take care of that, it's not my job. But not only that, if I'm taking information and bringing it out and I'm the only one, I'm wrong. And what we have seen in our culture, we have developed a culture of people who are quick to believe. And in Bible terms, they call that a fool. The Bible says the foolish believe every word. That is a fool. I'm not calling you a fool. God calls you a fool. When you hear this report and you begin to spread it, and it could be about your next door neighbor or a mayor or a governor or a president, and when you choose to believe it and spread it, God says that is a fool. Only a fool would do that. And I challenge you, make your social media match biblical morality. I challenge you to raise your children. Forbid your children from being gossips. I remember, it may still be there. I don't know, it's been years since I've been there. But when I was a kid at Disneyland, there was an old-fashioned candy shop. And you'd go into that candy shop, and there were these old-fashioned folds, crank handle, you could listen. And they were models of the old party lines. When I was a kid, very, very young, but school age enough that I used the telephone, we had, I don't know how many people on our party line, and I didn't know who they were. But you picked the phone up. If you didn't get a dial tone, you were real quiet and listen, because you'd get to hear two other people talking. And often when you were talking, you could hear a click. It sounded different. And so my brother and I, we were home a lot, summertime alone. We'd pick up the phone just to hear what's going on. And then we'd get quiet and someone would say, is somebody on this line? You hang up. You get off the phone. Well, you know, because that's gossip. You're stealing information. That's what the federal government and Google does all the time with you and me, with our devices. But you know, those phones, you pick those phones up, and we would sit there in the candy store and laugh because this lady's gossiping about that lady, and this lady's gossiping about that lady. And we're sitting here listening. You know, gossips are a joke. Gossips and slanders are a joke, and they're fools. And right now in our culture, there's an awful lot of gossip, slanders, and fools who believe them. But I'll tell you, I love that my God is just. And he leads me, he leads you. If we'll yield our lives to him, he knows where we are, what we're facing, what we're doing. And our God, there's no point. He that reproveth the scorner, Proverbs says, getteth himself shamed. There's no point in going to that scornful, critical, slander, and trying to correct them. A scorner will not be corrected by words. You can't correct them. You smite the scorner, and the simple will beware. Though thou grind a fool in mortar and pestle, yet will not his foolishness depart from thee. You can grind a fool to pieces, and they're still going to be a fool. So don't worry about it. And I don't know how our political leaders do it, but they somehow survive it, and they go on. And I want to encourage you, let's us not be the gossips. Let's us not be the slanderers. Let's us not be the ones who bring up things that we have not documented. And if an old Jewish priest or Pharisee knew enough Bible to say, does our law condemn a man before it hear him? Then maybe we better be very careful about condemning someone on social media before we actually go to them face to face and ask them. And if we're not the judge, we're not supposed to condemn them anyway. We're not the one to do the inquisitiveness. We're not the one to pass judgment. It's not, unless I'm the executioner who's supposed to put this person in jail, it's not my job to destroy their name. It's not my job to destroy their character. It's not my job. Remember when Sarah Palin ran for vice president for a little while? She was in the running, and remember how they attacked her? And here's just a lovely lady, a governor, a mother, a wife, a conservative. She couldn't fit with the liberals because she's pretty and she hunted and she was married and she was nice. Oh, the media destroyed that gal. The sad thing is a whole lot of people read it and believed it. And you know, I'm so grateful we've got a just God, because God's the one that we need to please. And I hope you'll pray for your political leaders. They are in a war, and our nation is at war. And there's a great, great battle going on right now in our culture between evil and good, between right and wrong, between honest and decent and shameful and deceitful. Oh, guard how much TV you let in your house. Guard the social media. And let's let God guide us. Have a great week. Let's pray for our country. Difficult days for some people right now, especially in the political realm. Pray for these good people trying to do right. I just believe there's some great people in law enforcement, great people in our military, great people in political world, in the political world. And I think a lot of them are trying to do right. Let's pray for them. Let's ask God's blessing on our churches. And thank you again for the great day yesterday. I sure appreciate your love and faithfulness and encouragement to the work of God. Have a great day, and let's pray for a great week.